that the church must have been praying that I don't sing again or get the opportunity, because I was looking for the perfect illustration to start my sermon off with this morning. And in my head, the best illustration I could come up with, because I looked at a lot of them, and I said, what's going to really get the people's attention and help them to understand clearly where I'm trying to go with this message? I'm going to sing this song. That's what I said. And I get here this morning, and the person who was supposed to play the song, last name Johnson, start with an S. I ain't gonna put him out there like that. He didn't play, he don't have his music ready. So I don't know how to take that. Is that the Lord don't want me to sing this morning? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna listen to the Holy Spirit of God this morning, and I'm going to read you the words to this song, okay? Because I really can't change it, because the song lines up with the title of my message, and it should give you an overall picture of where we're trying to go this morning. So here's the words to this song without me singing it. I couldn't seem to fall asleep. There was so much on my mind, searching for that peace, but the peace I could not find. So then I kneeled down to pray, praying, help me please. But then he said, you don't have to cry, because I'll supply all your needs. As soon as I stopped worrying how the story ends, I let go and I let God have his way. This is the part I really was looking forward to singing. I was going to do my Kirk Franklin thing and say, this is what y'all really need to pay attention to. That's when things start happening. I stopped looking at back then. I let go and I let God have his way. It says, there's so much going on. Sometimes I can't find my way. And oftentimes I struggle from day to day. I have to realize it's not my battle. It's not my battle to fight. I have to know, if I put it in your hands, that everything will be all right. And then the song says, as soon as I stop worrying how the story ends, I let go and I let God have his way. And that's when things started happening. I think the illustration would have been a lot more powerful if the Lord would have just let me sing that this morning. But by the grace of God, we'll go ahead and go to our text. Turn to Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28. Hopefully, with us reading this text, you can understand why I read the words to that song, Let Go and Let God. And hopefully at the end of the sermon, maybe something that the Lord may use me to say will help you with whatever you're going through this morning, that you will let it go and you'll trust God to handle it. In Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28, the Bible says, Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I had the title of this sermon this morning. I would title it, Let Go and Let God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you and we thank you for another opportunity to be in your house and to preach your word. We're praying, Father God, that your will be done here this morning. We're praying, Lord, if there's anyone here and they're not saved this morning, that today will be the day of salvation for them. Lord, for those of us who are already saved, help us to realize, Father God, that we are not in this battle alone, that you are here to help us. And Lord, whatever we're going through, you care about it. Lord, we're casting all of our cares upon you this morning. And we're thanking you in advance, Father God, for what you're going to do in this service. And not only in this service, but in our lives. We give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Now go back to Matthew chapter 11 and look at verse 7. Because Matthew chapter 11 and verse 7, the Bible tells us who Jesus was talking to. It says in verse 7, in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 7, it says, "And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitude concerning John." Now in verses 7 through verses 19, Jesus talks to this multitude or this group of individuals about John the Baptist. In verses 20 through 24, Jesus Christ rebuked these Galilean cities for not repenting of their wicked ways and coming to him. And then in verses 25 through 27, Jesus Christ lifts up a prayer to the Father. And then in verse 28, Jesus invites all those who labor and are heavy laden to come to him. And he promises them that he will give them rest. In verse 28, Jesus Christ told them to come unto me. Now, who was Jesus Christ talking to when he said come? We will understand clearly who he was talking to when we look at the two verbs that he used. The first verb that he used is labor. Labor is kopaio in the Greek. And it carries the idea of someone who is at the end of their rope. They're at the point of utter exhaustion. They're weary. They're at the point that they can't take another step, that they can't go any further. This person is just plain worn out. Now, the Bible isn't exactly clear to what kind of labor or what kind of heavy lading these individuals were involved in. But as you study the scripture and study what was going on around Christ, we can somewhat get a conclusion of what was going on. It's possible that some of these people were tired because they were trying to have a relationship with God apart from Christ. Trying to work your way to heaven will wear you out. It is also possible that these people could have been tired just from everyday life. Either group, guess what Jesus said? Jesus said, come. Now, what are some things that can wear us down today? Some things that can make us grow weary? Work, doing too much, worldliness, trying to keep up with the Joneses. Not those Joneses, but just trying to keep up with the Joneses. Not learning how to be content and discontent at the same time. Rituals and traditions, rules and regulations, sin and guilt, all of those things will wear you down after a while. The religious leaders of this day were adding to the law. They were adding rules to what people had to do to have a relationship with God. Anytime that we allow people to add rules or change the word of God, it can make it very difficult to try to live this Christian life. The second verb that Jesus used was heavy laden. Heavy laden means that this person was, they have reached their the boiling point. They just couldn't take it no more. They were under extreme pressure. Go to Matthew chapter 23. I'll show you a little bit of what was going on at this time that Jesus was talking to these individuals. Matthew 23, and look at verse 1. The Bible says, "Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples." And this is what he said. He said, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. And then look at verse 4. He says, for they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Laborious and weighty are the rules and regulations that come from man. Trying to live a life pleasing to man will kill you. This is why Jesus told this group, he said, I need y'all to come to me. And Matthew 9 and verse 36 tells us exactly what Jesus saw when he saw the multitude. In Matthew 9 and verse 36, the Bible said, but when he saw the multitude, Jesus was moved with compassion on them. Because they fainted, they were tired, they were weary. And he said they were scattered abroad as sheep, having no shepherd. Jesus said people need a shepherd, not a list of strict rules. When people come to church, we don't tell them a list of what you should and shouldn't do. We teach them about Christ. Keeping the law could never save a man. Look at what Paul says in Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. Keeping the law could never save a man. Romans chapter 3 and verse 20, Paul says, therefore, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. And this is what Paul is saying. He says, we know that we are sinners because if we even try to keep the law, we are going to fail. Galatians chapter 2 and verse 16, Paul puts it this way. He said, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law. But then he lets you know how a man can be justified. He said, a man can be justified by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ. And not by works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Anyone who is burdened down because of sin, or trying to do what's right, or trying to live right, or trying to stay away from those things that's doing wrong, guess what Jesus Christ is saying to you this morning? He's saying the same thing he said to them. He said, come. In 1 Timothy 1, verse 15, Paul said, this is a faithful saying, and we know that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Now, if you already saved this morning, you recognize that the Christian life is not without burdens, it's not without trials, it's not without troubles. But I love this calling that Christ does, because the word come is so simple. The word is so simple that a baby can understand the concept. You know, with me being a daddy, I love when my kids are going through something and I say, come to daddy. Come to daddy. Come to daddy. And you know what my kids do? They look at me just like how y'all looking at me, and they go to their mama. I don't understand that. I don't understand that. Because daddy is here. I don't understand that. I just wanted to see y'all, the way y'all looking at me is exactly how my kids look at me. And they run to their mama. I'm like, what is going on? But Jesus is good in telling people to come to me. Look at Mark chapter 1 and verse 17. Mark chapter 1 and verse 17. Well, start with verse 16. Now, as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. Look at what Jesus said. He said unto them, come ye after me, and I will make you fishers of men. Go to Mark chapter 6 and verse 31. Mark chapter 6 and verse 31. Jesus said unto them, come ye yourselves apart into a desert place, and come with me and rest for a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. Jesus said, come with me, let's go rest for a while. Go to John chapter 1 and verse 38. John chapter 1 and verse 38. Then Jesus turned and saw them following, and said unto them, what seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? And he said unto them, come and see. And they came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. Look at John 21. And look at verse 12. John 21, verse 12. Jesus says unto them, what did he say? Come and dine. And none of his disciples durst ask him, who art thou, knowing that it was the Lord. He said, come and dine. In John 14 and verse 6, Jesus says unto them, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And this is what he said, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus is still telling people in 2017, come unto me. Now, the rest that Jesus is offering, it can't be bought. It's free. Eternal life is a free gift from God. I love what Jesus told them in verse 29 of Matthew chapter 11. Now, I love verse 28 because coming to Jesus was one of the best decisions that I ever made. But verse 29 is real personal to me, because Jesus told them to not just come, but he said, learn of me as well. He says, don't just come to me, but learn of me as well. Before he gave them the command to learn of me, he told them, I want you to do something. He said, take my yoke upon you. And somebody should be putting up a picture about this time. There we go. He said, take my yoke. You see the yoke? Show the next picture, please. Now, I appreciate what you're doing back there first. I want to say that. I had the definition with that picture. I don't know where the definition went. So I'm going to have to read it, because I was going to read it while it was up there. But this is the definition. It says, a yoke is a wooden beam normally used between a pair of oxen or other animals to enable them to pull together on a load when working in pairs. As oxen usually do, some yokes are fitted to individual animals. Now, the stronger animal would get the heavier side. In the Bible days, the word yoke carried different meanings. In Jewish literature, a yoke represents the sum total of obligation which, according to the teaching of a rabbi to a person, that would take those teachings upon themselves. Taking one yoke was used of studying with a rabbi. What that means is that the rabbi would say, take my yoke, my teaching, and learn of me or learn from me. I want you to be my disciple. Yoke was a well-known image of the law. And in the Bible days, we have terminology of the yoke of the Torah, yoke of commandments, the yoke of the kingdom of heaven. Look at what Peter said in Acts chapter 15 about this word yoke. He was talking to the Jewish leaders concerning the salvation of the Gentiles. And look at what he said to them in Acts chapter 15 and verse 10. Acts chapter 15 and verse 10, he said, now therefore, why tempt ye God? To do what? Here it is. He's letting them know you're trying to put more on their shoulders than necessary. He said, and then he makes it clear. He says, which neither our fathers nor we are able to what? We can't keep the law. As much as we try to keep these rules and regulations, we can't do it. But I love verse 11 because verse 11, this is what he says. He says, but we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they. Now, when it comes to animals, there are different sizes and different kinds of yokes. But when it comes to man and come to the yoke that Christ is offering, we don't have different sizes. We don't have small, medium, large, and in some cases, extra large, and maybe in my case, extra, extra large. But when it comes to Christ, one size fits all. And this is what Christ said. He said, my yoke, he said, you take my yoke, it's easy. Go back to Matthew chapter 11. He said, you take my yoke, and I'm going to exchange it for something. One thing I'm grateful for in this Christian life is that I have learned how to take Christ's yoke and trust him. This Christian life is challenging at times. And it's a beautiful thing when you are linked up with the Lord Jesus Christ. I can't tell you how many times things have come up in my life and it's heavy, and it's heavy on my shoulders. The weight, I can feel the weight. I can feel the pressure. And guess what? I have to remember the word of God and I apply it to my life. And at the times I feel that weight and I feel that pressure, I go to Christ and I go to my prayer closet and I say, Lord, here I am again. You promised me that if I allow you to come into my life and help me with this situation, that you can handle this. And I can't tell you, I might share it with you one day because I write it all down. I really do. I'm planning on releasing this book someday. But I write it all down. Everything that God has done in my life, I write it all down in a journal. I keep track of it. Because when I'm gone, I don't want my kids to not be able to see what it was that God did in their daddy's life. And I forget stuff. So, you know, you can share a testimony, but you forget stuff. And there's so much that I have been through that was heavy that I have forgotten because God has taken it away from me. But I can go back and I can read and say, man, I forgot about that. That was, and I can read how I felt at that time. I was scared. Sometimes I was scared. Sometimes I was afraid. And I went to God, and guess what he did? He kept his end of the deal. And here, Jesus says, take my yoke upon you. But he says something else. He said, I want you to learn of me. The word learn carries the idea of become my disciple. This is what Jesus said. Let me be your teacher and you be my student. This is what he's saying. He said, I want you to learn from me. Now, it must amaze God on how many Christians claim to know God and know his word, and yet they're not humble. I think God probably looking down sometimes, amazed at how many people say that they know God and say that they know Christ, and yet they're not humble. One thing I've learned about this book, if you keep reading it and keep studying it and living it, it can't do nothing but humble you. Jesus said, learn from me. And look at what he says in verse 29. He said, for I am meek and lowly in heart. Learning about Jesus should teach you and I how to be humble. Go to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. And look at what Paul had to say about Christ. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5. He said, let this mind be in you. Which what? He said, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made of himself what? No reputation. And took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, what did Christ do? Now remember verse 5, he says, let this mind be in who? You, which was also in Christ Jesus. Jesus humbled himself and he became obedient unto the death, even the death of the cross. And because of that humility, the Bible says God exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. If you read the word of God, you'll see time and time again, God says the way up is to go down. When you go down, eventually God will bring you up. It amazes me how people are not interested today in learning how to be humble. People are not interested in learning about Jesus. People in general are more interested in learning what's going on in Jay-Z and Beyonce's life. We're more concerned with what's going on with Kanye and Kim. I dare to say that some people here know more about Kevin Hart than they know about Jesus. People want to know what's going on in the lives of the people that's on Facebook. They can tell you more about technology, Harry Potter, 50 Shades of Grey, Old Magazine, than they can tell you about Jesus. Even in the church. During football season, there was a saying that they were saying. And this is what they said. Come on, man. And I say that this morning, like, are you serious? In the church, we know more about these worldly things than we know about Christ. Last week, I had the opportunity to attend a town hall meeting. And at this meeting, they were discussing issues that are going on in the school with the kids. And this is what they said. They said, kids are dropping out. And kids are getting kicked out. They says kids are coming to school with all kinds of problems today. And I will be honest with you, this is where I need God's help. You understand? Because in my flesh, I'm sitting here like, what kind of problem do they have? They don't have to pay bills. They get to eat whatever they want to. Don't have to spend no money. They leave lights on. My kids, when we go to the store, all my kids talk about what they want. And then I tell them, we don't have no money. They say, go in your pocket. They don't have a concept of what life really is. But then I have to remember and be sympathetic with their situation and understand what they're dealing with. Because these kids today are dealing with a lot more than what I had to deal with when I was a child. They said that these kids are frustrated. These kids are angry. These kids are lost and disappointed. They have so much to deal with. And I listed a few things that they have to deal with today. They have to deal with police brutality, racism, death of their daddy, death of their mama, death of their uncles being murdered, or death of their good friend being murdered. They got to deal with peer pressure. They got problems in the home. They got to deal with drugs and immorality. And the issue is very few are stressing to these kids the importance of them learning more about Jesus Christ. We as leaders in the church and as parents and grandparents are making a colossal mistake when we don't see the long-term effect of not teaching these kids more about Jesus in this earth. It's a grave mistake to not understand the importance of teaching these kids about Christ. But watch this. If we as adults don't understand the importance of studying Christology, if we as adults are not concerned about learning more about Christ, if we're not reading our Bibles and we're not studying and we're not on our knees praying and asking God, Lord, please teach me more about Christ. No wonder the world is the way it is today. And it's not going to get any better if we're not concerned about learning more about Christ and we're not concerned about teaching others about Christ, the world's not going to get any better. Now, don't misunderstand. I know that we live in this world. I realize that. But in a spiritual sense, it will not help our kids or us to learn more about politics, making money, being successful, what's right, what's wrong, who should be president, who shouldn't be president, sports, Hollywood, or any other subject more than we learn about Christ. In a spiritual sense. So in verse 28, Jesus told them, he said, I want y'all to come unto me. In verse 29, Jesus told them, you can't just stop there. Don't just come and don't learn. I want you to learn some things about me. Then in verse 30, Jesus told them, I can make your life easier. He says, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I want to tell you, I can testify this morning that Jesus Christ can make your life easier. I'm asking the church to pray for me because I've been on this mission for 18 years and I'm almost complete with what it is that God has told me to do. And one thing that has been on my heart from day one since God has came and got Sean Moore is to make sure I share what he had done in my life with as many people as I possibly can. Especially when I see what's going on in this world today. I can tell you for the last 18 years of my life hasn't been easy, but it's been easier. It's been easier. I'm telling you, I have some things that come up and my wife and I, we go pray about it. I mean, and I just have to say this. Men, you got to compliment your wife sometimes, you know. I'm so grateful for my wife because she has really grown in faith these last 6 years. I go to her now and I tell her something will come up and I go share with her. And guess what she say? God got it. Don't worry about nothing. We're going to pray about it. He done did it before. He'll do it again. Man, it's a blessing to have that kind of woman by your side. Because you know what? If I didn't have that, then I would have to make some things happen, right, men, to keep the home happy. But because she has grown in faith, now when things come up, I can go to her, and guess what she said? She said, we ain't going to worry about it. We're going to pray. And I be wanting to, you know, tell her. I wasn't telling you so we can worry about it. I was telling you so you would know what's going on. At the end of verse 29, Jesus said, when you learn of me, you shall find rest unto your souls. It's nothing like the rest that God gives you. And that's what I'm trying to say this morning. You know, when you linked up with Jesus and you know that he's going to take care of everything, you can rest. Yeah, I'm not bragging. It's by the grace of God. I'm going to tell you, I get good sleep all the time. I don't have a problem with it. My baby tell you, I can take a nap anytime. I can take a nap. My soul is at peace right now. I'm telling you, it's at peace. This is what Jesus said. He said, you will find rest for your soul. What he said, you will find relief. You will find peace. Why? Because of verse 30. This is what he said. He said, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I want you to think of areas where you might or you where you need to find rest this morning. Something working your nerves. I want you to think about it right now. And I want you to meditate on Jesus' invitation to them and to us. This is what Jesus said, come. Now, what was Jesus really saying when he said, come? Look at John chapter 4 and look at verse 14. What was Jesus really saying when he said, come? Look at John chapter 4 and verse 14. He said, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I should give him shall what? Don't you want that kind of water? But the water that I should give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Look at John chapter 6 and verse 35. John chapter 6 and verse 35. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Jesus is saying that when you come to me, I'm going to be all that you will ever need. Look at 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. And look at verse 1. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begot loveth him also that is begotten of him. But this we know, that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. He said, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And look at what he said. His commandments are not what? They're not grievous. They're not burdensome. Verse 4 says, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. This is, to sum all that up, this is what Jesus is saying, or what the Bible is saying about Christ and his work. Jesus said, the work that I have for you to do, the load that I'm asking you to carry, is not going to be heavy, because I will be here by your side to take and carry the heavy side or the heavy load. I don't care how tough your Christian life is today. Your life will always be easier with Christ than without Christ. Now, there's this new movie that just came out. I haven't been able to see it yet. It's called Sully. And Sully is about this pilot who took off, and he, I guess about a minute and a half after he was up in the air, they hit a flock of geese. So he had to make a decision on what to do, and the story says that he landed the plane in the Hudson River. And nobody, the plane didn't crash. So I guess you would think going through that, people would have been burdensome, they would have been troubled, they would have been distraught. But once they landed in the water, they had another problem. About a minute or two while they were sitting on the water, the plane started to sink. So the Coast Guard had to come, and others from New York would have to come and try to rescue the people. Now, we know the end of the story is that everybody was rescued. What would we say about a person who was on that plane and the people who came to rescue them? The people that are on the plane said, don't worry about nothing. We done made it through the first stage of this. Don't worry about it. We gonna make it to shore on our own. What would you say about that kind of an individual? What would you say? You said, that's some foolish stuff right there. That somebody's here to help you. And you say, nah, I got this. I got this. And when you sit and think about it, that's the mindset of most of the people that's in the church. God is here for us. God's word is here for us. And a lot of times, guess what we say? I got this. And want me to show you how I can prove to you you have that kind of attitude? The moment you wake up in the morning and you don't read your Bible and you start your day off without the word of God, and I'm not saying you necessarily have to have devotion early in the morning, but that's probably the best time, because I've been doing this now for 18 years. If you don't do it in the morning, it's going to be very difficult to find time throughout the day to read your Bible. You can play with me all you want to, but I know. But some people read their Bible in the evening, some read it at night. I understand that. But if you can go a whole day without reading your Bible, guess what you're telling God? I know you're here to help me, but I got this. And let me say this, it's evident when people have that kind of attitude, because you can see that, you can see their heavy, they weigh down. You can see it on people's face when they're going through things. And Christ is right here all the time saying, come unto me. All you that are laboring and that are heavy laden, he said, come. And we say, I know you're there for me, but I got this. Go to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm done. Hebrews chapter 12, and look at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, the Bible says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us." And then he says, "Let us run with patience the race that is set before us." So first you need to lay aside what? Lay aside those things that are weighing you down, those things that you are cumbered about, those things that you are worrying about, those things that's causing you stress. Bring that stuff to Christ. And how do you do that? Verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus. You got to keep your eyes on Christ. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I want to encourage you this morning, if you're going through something, if you're weighted down, remember the words of Christ. He said, "Come unto me. You're not in this by yourself. You wasn't created to do this by yourself." Remember what we just said about somebody that would be in the river stranded and they refused to get help. If you're in that situation this morning, welcome to the club. Because truthfully, all of us at one time or another, we need to come to Christ and say, "Lord, I can't do this on my own. I need your help." I can't tell you how many times in the 18 years that I've been doing this now that I done went to God and said, "Lord, I cannot do this anymore. I don't want to do this. I'm tired. I am tired. And dealing with people, Lord, I am tired. Tired. Why do I always got to be the one to take the low road? I got to be the one to be God-like. They saved too, amen? Amen? Am I the only one to feel that way? I'm like, they are saved too. Well, you know how many times people that are saved come and apologize to Sean Moore? For something they done said, something they done did? It ain't that often. You know how many times I got to go and apologize to people? But you know what? That's that process of learning from Christ. Being humble. What I'm saying this morning is don't stop growing and realize that you don't have to live this Christian life all by yourself. Christ said, if there's something that's got you way down this morning, come. Come to him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, help us, Lord, to realize, Lord, that there's going to be some things in this world that's going to weigh us down. And Lord, we need to have enough wisdom to know that you are here to help us. Help us, teach us how to pray, Father God. Teach us how to trust you more. Teach us how to live this life by faith and not by sight. Lord, your word teaches us that the just shall live by faith. Lord, this is a faith walk. No matter what's going on this morning, Father God, in our life, Lord, we say we trust you. We trust you, Father God. Help us, Lord, to continue to lay down our burdens at your feet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.